We'll start. Okay, good morning, everybody. And welcome to God's house. For those of you who are watching online, we don't know where everybody is. They must have gotten in trouble this weekend. Or it's a long weekend, folks are gone. So anyway, welcome to God's house. Today is the second Sunday after Epiphany. And we're going to start with the pre-service song, Come to Jesus, which, if I remember, is an old Vacation Bible School song, isn't it? I think so. So let us begin with Come to Jesus. Welcome you to God's house. Today is the second Sunday after Epiphany, and our theme is on being connected to the Lord Jesus Christ. So, you'll see the prayer before worship printed out in your worship folder, and why don't we pray that prayer together, okay? Join me, please. Dear Lord Jesus, you have called me by the gospel to come and follow you. Dear Holy Spirit, thank you for opening my heart and mind to receive and accept Jesus as my personal Savior and Lord. Thank you for those who placed in my life
who witnessed to me about Jesus.
Help me to have a growing personal relationship with Christ as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to continue with the opening song, Arise and Sing. We'll sing it through twice. We're not going to sit and sing. So arise and sing.
Arise and sing, ye shall. your hearts and rejoice before Him. Open up your hearts and rejoice before Him. Open up your hearts and rejoice before Him, for the King is our God. Oh, rise and sing, ye children of Zion, for the Lord has delivered thee. Arise and sing, ye children of Zion, for the Lord has delivered thee. Open up your hearts and rejoice before Him. Open up your hearts and rejoice before Him. Open up your hearts and rejoice before Him. For the King is our God. For the King is our God. For the King is our God.
Please turn to the next page and we begin our time together in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of God the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with the responses on God's call. O Lord, You have called us out of the darkness of sin and unbelief into the light of Your truth and salvation.
We are Your people, those called out of this world to love and serve You. We are those called to be Your disciples. We are witnesses of the truth.
Some of us, dear Lord, have sought You, especially in the low moments of life. We've called upon You to help and reveal Yourself to us. You tell us, He who calls upon Me, I will not cast away. Come, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
Some of us You have sought and enlisted us to follow You, as You called Jonah and Moses, Paul and Philip, so too, some of us, You have spoken these words, come and follow Me.
Some of us, dear Lord, You have called to follow You through others, our parents or friend, a spouse, even a child can become Your instruments to call people to follow You. So remind us of those people who opened to us the gospel and introduced us to Jesus. Today we take time to praise You for the call You issued to each of us to follow You. We praise You for placing people into our lives who lead us to You. We honor You for opening our minds and hearts when we sought You. Now with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we join our voices and sing. The song of praise is, Come and See.
Of the Lord, come behold the Lamb.
together we pray the prayer for the day. Join me. Dear Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, empower us this day to be your instruments, to lead others to the gospel and the gift of salvation. Help us to see events in our lives as opportunities to be used by you to call others to your grace and mercy. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Please take time to greet those around you this morning. Man, you guys talked a long time today. Holy cow. That's good. Remember when we never did greeting of peace?
Yes.
I don't know what it would be like without doing it. I suppose there are churches that never do it, correct? Right? Did they? All right, take out your Bibles and turn to page 423. Yes, we are. For those of you who are watching and maybe not from Southern California, we're freezing here in Southern California. It goes down to at least 40 degrees at night, 38 maybe, and we can hardly stand it. Of course, if it was 40 below, we'd all be dead, right? I shouldn't laugh at that, should I? All right, 1 Samuel chapter 3. Would you turn to it, please? And you remember Samuel, the young kid who hung around in the temple. And our theme today is God calling people. And we're going to only read the first 10 verses of this section, okay? And why don't we do it together? So we're going to stop after verse 10, okay? Would you join me? Everybody there? All right. The Lord calls Samuel. Together, please. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare, There were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel. Samuel answered, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." But Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." So he went and lay down. Again, the Lord called Samuel. Samuel got up, went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." "My son," Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel a third time. Samuel got up, went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. The Lord came and stood there, calling as at the other times, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Can you imagine that? You see that, verse 10? The Lord came and stood there. All right, turn to John chapter 1, please. And this you will find on page 1647. I also made another mistake here. We're going to start at verse 29, not verse 19. Okay? All right, John chapter 1, starting with verse 29. We'll read this in the minute, in a minute. Everybody there? Are you there, Missy? Isn't it wonderful you know where to turn in your Bible? How'd you like to be someone who has no idea where anything in the Bible is? There's lots of people like that. So one of the major themes of the Bible is that God calls people and involves them in his work here in this world, okay? God literally calls people to be involved in his work here in this world. That was true in the Old Testament. Can you name some? How about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? They were called. How about Moses? You think he was called by God? Yeah, and Moses made every excuse in the book. Wasn't he the guy that made like five excuses why he didn't want to go? Then there was Joshua, and finally, and Samuel today, and many, many others, okay? God's presence with his people. I want you to think about this for a moment. Think of God's presence with his people in this world. Applies to our relationship with Almighty God. That God is present with his people here in this world. Okay? Now let me read this. No people, no matter how religious they may be, if they are without God's presence in their lives, they have nothing to do with God. Let me say that again. No people, no matter how religious they may be, how ethical, how religious they may be, if they don't have the presence of Almighty God in their lives, it is what? Nothing. It's empty. That is happening with millions of our fellow Americans, I'm afraid. We'll come to that later, okay? So, the presence of Almighty God in our lives is a powerful theme of our verses for today, all right? So, page 1647, we're going to start with verse 29. I'm going to have you read this, okay? Or we'll read together. And then we'll move on. All right? Let's read. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel. Then John gave this testimony, 'I saw the Spirit coming down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him, except that the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, "The man on whom you speak, the Spirit come down and remain, is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God."" We're going to take this in parts, so just keep your Bibles open. So we begin with John the Baptist, who prepared the way of the Lord. John's preparation included two things: preaching, calling people to what? Repent, to change their ways and to recognize their sin. And the second was to be baptized by him, okay? He calls Jesus, look at the verses, he calls Jesus two titles: the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. That is huge. And at the bottom, he calls him the Son of God. What's the imagery of the Lamb of God? Anybody, you remember? Come on, let's hear it. Old Testament, right? On what day? Day of Atonement. Remember that? When the high priest went into the temple, into the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was, and he took the blood of the Lamb and sprinkled it on the Ark as a sign that Israel's sins were forgiven. Powerful stuff. So Jesus is called by John the Lamb of God, okay? The other one, he is called the Son of God. Powerful statements, all right? All right, let's move on. So notice John's witness to Jesus, all right? Let's move on. Together, please. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Let's just stop there for a moment. So up until this time, they were following John. And John says, "There's the Lamb of God." They leave John real fast, and they go after Jesus. Okay, let's go on. Where are we? When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying and spent the day with him. It was about the 10th hour. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah," that is, the Christ, and he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated is Peter. Let's stop there for a moment, okay? So the next day, again, there are disciples of John, and he says, "Look, the Lamb of God," okay? So those two now follow Jesus. And what's the first words out of Jesus' mouth? I think about that. That's sort of funny to me, or odd, let me say. And how he said it, I wonder how he said it. "What do you want?" Or, "What do you want?" But the words in John's gospel, I'm sure the other gospels are a little different, But the first words out of Jesus' mouth is, what do you want? Okay? And they ask, Rabbi, where are you staying? So he says, well, come and see. All right? So they spend the day with him. And Andrew is one of them. Andrew, of course, goes to his brother Simon Peter. All right? And notice what he says to Peter. We have found whom? Ooh, this is huge. We have found the Mashiach, the Messiah, that is the Christ. And then Andrew brings him to Jesus. Here's another encounter, okay? You got to appreciate these encounters. Jesus says, you are Simon, son of John. And then he says what? Oh, by the way, I'm going to change your name. You're going to be called Cephas, right? You're going to be called Cephas, which when it's translated into Greek is called Petros, for the rock. Peter's going to become the rock. As someone said, the stone of stability for the disciples. What do we learn from this? What do we learn from this encounter? Jesus knows what? Oh, come on. He knows the future. He knows what Peter will become. He knows right at the beginning who Peter will be and what he will be. That's something. All right. Are you ready? Let's move on. Together, please. Verse 43, the next day Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, follow me. Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, we have found the one Moses wrote about in the law and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Now let's just stop there for a moment. Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. But Philip goes and finds who? His buddy, okay? His buddy, Nathanael. Notice what Philip says. We have found Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. That doesn't sound very godly, does it? He's Jesus of, you know, that little town of Nazareth over there where nothing good comes from that. We're going to hear that in a moment. And he's the son of Joseph. Let's go on. Verse 46. With me? Nazareth. Can anything good come from there? Nathanael asked. Come and see, said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, here is a true Israelite in whom there is nothing false. How do you know me? Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, I saw you while you were still under the fig tree, before Philip called you. Nathanael declared, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus said, you believe because I saw you under the fig tree? You shall see greater things than that. He then added, I tell you the truth. You will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. Notice Nathanael. He's an interesting guy. Nathanael gets a compliment from Jesus. Did you notice that? Here's a guy in whom there is nothing false, no guile, no, not a cheater. Nathanael was a true Israelite, followed the law of God, okay? He wasn't a fake, he wasn't a cheater. He truly tried and endeavored to follow the will of God. And Nathanael is amazed that Jesus knew him beforehand, and he calls him, did you catch this? You are Rabbi, you are the Son of God, you are the King of Israel, okay? So this is, and then he finishes out, you will all see greater things than this. All right, part two of the sermon. What did you notice in these three little sections? What did you notice? Oh, come on. How about all the titles? There are 9 to 10 of them. All of these titles of Jesus. Okay? Now let me go through it. The title are, he's the Lamb of God, he's Rabbi or Teacher, okay? He's Christ or Messiah. A lot of these have, okay, twos. The one Moses and the prophets wrote about. See, we forget that. Jesus is the one whom the prophets and Moses wrote about, all right? He is Jesus of Nazareth, son of Joseph. What does that pertain to? His human side. We know where he came from, okay? Here in this world, all right? Let me finish this out. Son, he is the King of Israel, the Son of God, and King of Israel, and he's the Son of Man. What's the point of this all? This Jesus is quite the guy. Yes? This Jesus becomes the focal point and the center and the presence of God here in this world among these people and with us today. Let me say this to you, and we need to understand that. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus is your rabbi. He's the one who teaches you. He is the Savior. He is the Son of Man and the Son of God. Jesus is the focal point of God's presence among his people here in this world. Call upon me in the day of trouble and I will deliver you. Where two or three are gathered together in my name, continue, finish it out, there am I in the midst of you. Let me say this, folks, I am finding this. I never thought this so much. The center of our Christian faith is not a bunch of morals. It's not ethics. That's not the center of our faith. That's part of it. The center of our faith is not some history or some God somewhere out there, unknowable and unknown. The center of your faith and mine has got to be the Lord Jesus Christ, who is all of these things and more in your life and mine. One of the things I'm afraid, and I hope I'm wrong, and maybe I am, but I think a lot of folks were raised in the church and never got connected to Jesus. You think that's true? They may have gotten connected to a men's group. They may have gotten connected to the kids in Sunday school. They may have gotten connected to the kids in the Lutheran school. They may have gotten connected to the LWML or the men's group or the choir. But did they ever get connected personally to the Lord Jesus? And that's the point of my sermon for today. The center of your life and mine as a child of God is not all the externals, not all the trappings, okay? Not the Lutheran church versus something else. The center of our life of faith is the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want you to ask yourself this question. Is he the focus of your life of faith? Or is he not? Is Jesus just a nice guy, a good moral man, an example to follow? Is Jesus just something I think about when my parents drag me to church? Or is he something I think about when I got trouble and problems? But otherwise, you know, I don't really care. I'm afraid that there's a lot of folks sitting in churches And I know there are those outside who are not connected to Jesus. And this is my prayer and my imperative for you. Make sure you're connected to Jesus, that you have this living personal relationship with Him. And if you don't have it, you know what I want to tell you to do? Find it and pray for Him to make Himself known to you. Okay? Pray for Him to make Himself more known to you. Any of you have a Jesus moment in your life? Let's see the hands. Let's see them. Not everybody. I had one too. I think I was about 8, 9, 10 years old, something like that. I can't remember exactly. And that presence just impacted me. And that changed me. And as you grow up, you got to stay close to Jesus. I think a lot of people's problems are they're not close to Jesus because they don't do the things, have the things of Jesus in their life. They're not in worship. They don't spend much time in prayer, only when they want something. Now you got to do this for me. Or they read their Bibles only when they're forced to. Like when they come to church here, you got to read your Bible. I'm serious about this. And I want to say to you, if you have people in your life, encourage them to come to Jesus and make Him the focal point of your life. And children, Jesus is everything. Some of you know that I'm attending this Bible class on Monday nights dealing with progressive Christianity, okay? And you've heard my sermons. You're probably sick of this, okay? Some of you think I'm exaggerating and I'm crazy, okay? And maybe I am. But we just had one lesson, and I'm reading the book that on the Ten Commandments of progressive Christianity. People of God, this is huge. In those churches, think about this. Inside the Church of Jesus Christ, Jesus is being set aside with these titles. He is not the one who died for me. He's just a martyr like other martyrs who lost their life. Jesus' primary function for a lot of people is he's a moral character that I should follow. He is not my Savior who died for me and rose again. And I want to say to you, be careful out there. And I want to say to you folks watching, you be careful out there. It's growing. This whole progressive thing, and I wish they'd get the word Christian out of it, because it's not Christian. Because Christianity is focused on who? Christ Jesus. Son of God, Son of Man, King of Israel, Rabbi, Teacher, Savior, Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So get connected to Him. And in this day and age where we have all this I don't even know what to call it, but it's all this religiosity, let me call it that. Stay connected to Jesus. All right, let me finish this out. Discipleship. I'm sorry I'm going on for this. Discipleship. These men became disciples of Christ. That means they became followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. Discipleship. This is what discipleship is. Discipleship requires a personal, life-changing, growing relationship and attachment to the Lord Jesus Christ that shapes my life and changes my life and gives me a new outlook on life. You understand that? So as you and to be connected to Jesus, I have a new outlook on life. My life is in His hands. Whatever it is, in Christ alone, whether I live or whether I die, I am the Lord's, okay? God can use me to be a blessing to others. We can witness the faith to other people. And I want to invite you to do that in your life. You don't have to jam Jesus down their throat, but let them see Jesus as the focus of your Christian life and faith. Again, it is an attachment to Jesus, not all the other externals that we see, but the attachment is to Jesus as your Lord and my Lord. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. We're going to continue with the offering, and then we're going to sing the song, Here I Am, Lord. All right? Which is a good one for the day.
Set a
Today, or this week, we begin our winter semester, or I guess we call it a semester, don't we, of ESL on Tuesday and Thursday evenings. And by the way, we've been getting phone calls, Clifford, ever since I put that sign up a week or so ago, we've been getting phone calls. So this is a wonderful way for us to engage people in the community, and especially, let me just say, new people, not only to our community, but to our country. We've had folks from the Ukraine recently arrived, people from other countries and who need English. And also, and thank goodness we have the food pantry, which is able to help these folks as well. So I'd like those of you involved in ESL, Cliff, who's here? We have you, anybody else? Eugene, come on down, Eugene. Anybody else? Is that about it? Oh, yes, Amy, come, Amy. So we have two, we have greeters, right? And how many teachers do we have? Four teachers, okay. All right, you guys can just stand here and face the congregation and here, and let's have a prayer. How long have you been doing this, Eugene? 3 years, on and off?
Probably about seven.
That long? Wow. Amy, how long have you been doing this?
Two or three.
Two or three? Okay, Cliff has been doing this since the last century. Thank you, Cliff, for putting this all together and recruiting people. Okay, so let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for this ministry that we have called English as a Second Language to help those who are new to our country or those who need to learn English better who live here. Dear Lord, thank you for this outreach ministry that not only helps them to learn and to function better in our culture and society, but also, dear Lord, help us to use this as an opportunity to introduce people to you, dear Jesus. And so, dear Lord, thank you for these men and women who are involved in this winter semester. We pray, dear Lord, that you will fill these classes as you have in the past, with people from around the world. How amazing that is, dear Lord. And may you use this ministry as your instrument to welcome and invite and call people to follow you, dear Jesus. So bless this semester. Fill it with your presence and your peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, thank you, guys. Have a good semester. All right, would you open up your hymn books to page 270, and after the prayers, we will use responsive prayer one. Page 270 in the front. All right, 270 in the front. So in our prayers for today, there are a number of folks for us to pray for. Grace Medrano, some of you know Grace. She's, I think, in her 90s, isn't she? And she's, arthritis is setting in, so we need to keep her in our prayers. Miles, who continues with a throat issue. I saw Carolyn Velsky this week, and she is in a new care facility up in Mission Hills or Granada Hills, whatever that is up there. We also want to pray for Phyllis Montoya's mother, Irene Russell. She is 93 years old. She lives in England. And it appears that her last days are here on this earth. So we want to pray for that. We also want to pray for increased enrollment in our preschool. Okay, this is the time of the year where new children come, and we want to pray for God's blessings on that. So let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, we come to you this second Sunday in the year, in the new year, and this second Sunday in the season of Epiphany, where we focus on our Lord Jesus Christ as true God, who has come from heaven above and is present among us still in this world. Dear Jesus, open each of our hearts that we may have a living, personal, loving relationship with you as our Savior. Dear Lord, I pray for all of those who are here and all who may be listening and watching, that you, dear Jesus, will make yourself known to them. in a personal way, that people will be connected to you and to understand that they are your disciples with an attachment to you, dear Jesus. Dear Lord, I pray for all those who have bought into the lie of new religious thought that you are not the Savior of the world, you're not true God. Dear Lord, I pray that they will come to know you as true God and true man, their teacher, their Messiah, their King, their Savior, their Lamb of God, who takes away their sin and the sin of the world. Lord, in your mercy. Today, dear Lord, we pray for all those dealing with health issues. We pray for Irene Russell in England, dear Lord, as it appears her life is coming to an end. May you, dear Jesus, surround her and may she be comforted by your presence and the gift of eternal life. Be with Phil and bless her and her family as they go through this time. We also pray this day for Grace Madrano, dear Lord. Give her renewed strength and renewed health. We pray for Carolyn Velsky and Miles Blakeney and Steve Walla as he prepares for a procedure in the weeks ahead. Dear Lord, watch over him. And bless all those on our prayer list, dear Lord. Give them a sense of your presence in their lives and also a sense of your peace, no matter what happens in whatever circumstance they may be. Lord, in your mercy. And finally, dear Lord, we take time to pray for increased enrollment in our preschool. We thank you, dear Lord, for the ministry of this school that has been here since the 1980s. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for our staff and our teachers. Thank you for our director. But also, dear Lord, and above all, we thank you that we are still a Christian school where Jesus is not set aside, but where Jesus is part of the curriculum. The day begins and ends with him. Dear Lord, we pray that you'll bless our school with new children, new families, that they may come here and grow and mature in their skills, but also that these families may be introduced to the Lord Jesus Christ. So, dear Lord, we pray for a full enrollment in our preschool. Lord, in your mercy. And finally, dear Lord, I pray for these United States of America and our fellow American citizens, especially those who have bought into the new philosophies and the new theologies of modernism and relativism. Dear Lord, I pray that the Lord Jesus Christ will be known by more and more people in our country, that there will be a humbling and a coming to Jesus in this world, in this country especially. Dear Lord, be with our churches, that they may maintain the teaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that many Americans will come to that joy of believing and trusting in Christ, and not some philosophy of man. Lord, in your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, let us use the responsive prayer 1, page 270. Holy God, holy and most gracious Father,
have mercy and hear us.
Together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our trespasses
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory, forever and ever. And today we confess our faith and notice which article has the most information. The one about Jesus. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. I cry to you for help, O Lord.
In the morning my prayer comes before you.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation.
And grant me a willing spirit to sustain me.
My mouth is filled with your praise.
Declaring your splendor all day long.
Every day I will praise you.
And extol your name forever and ever.
You answer us with awesome deeds of righteousness.
O God, our Savior, the hope of all the ends of the earth and of the farthest seas.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
All my inmost being, praise his holy name.
He redeems my life from the pit
and crowns me with love and compassion.
Lord, hear my prayer.
And let my cry come before you.
And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Turn the page and together we pray Luther's morning prayer. Join me. We give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have protected us through the night from all danger and harm. We ask you to preserve and keep us this day also from all sin and evil, that in all our thoughts, words, and deeds, we may serve and please you. Into your hands we commend our bodies and souls
and all that is ours. Let your holy
angels have charge of us, that the wicked one have no power over us. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord Almighty, order our days and our deeds in his peace. Amen. All right, a couple of announcements. Yard Day is this coming Saturday, and we have folks who have signed up. We also have folks from the preschool who are going to be painting the Jesus room. Remember the Jesus room over there? Kind of the long lost, forgotten. It used to be a garage years ago, right, John? I think so. Also, there's that, and you can read the Pastor Meyer. You may want to send a card to Pastor Meyer. And, we need people to pick up items at grocery stores Monday morning and also Thursday. And if you're able to help, you don't have to do it forever and ever till Jesus comes again, but we could use your help to do so, okay? Let's close with the closing song, I'm Following Jesus. It goes on to the back page, and this, I know, is a VBS song, right? Come on, Larry. By the way, Larry's cooking this Thursday for the folks in the pantry. I hope everybody survives his cooking. Oh, boy. Wow. All right, let's sing. Following Jesus. Got to do the hey, hey, hey's. Not too slow either. Wasn't for Jesus. Have a good week, everybody, and Jesus bless you.